This month in worship, we're focusing on compassion. Reverend Scott got us started last week with a sermon in which he affirmed psychotherapist David Richo's claim, compassion is love's response to pain. Sympathy is the ability to recognize that a person is in pain, Reverend Scott told us. And empathy is the ability to experience some of their feelings. Compassion, he continued, is putting those thoughts and feelings into action. We demonstrate compassion when we move beyond simply worrying about other people or the state of the world and try to do something about it. Compassion is a core Unitarian Universalist value. Our tradition claims that love is the most powerful force in human life. Love beats hate. In theist terms, we argue God is love, love is God. God loves everybody, no exceptions. In humanist terms, we recognize that love, more than anything else, is what knits human life together. And as Unitarian Universalists, we strive to be a loving community, instantiating amongst ourselves what Josiah Royce and then Martin Luther King Jr. called the beloved community. We struggle to be a space for everyone, without exception, where everyone can find their place and be encouraged and supported in living into their full human potential. And then we work to take that vision of the beloved community and live it out in the wider world. Compassion. Having sympathetic thoughts and feelings for others and then seeking to put those thoughts and feelings into action. Compassion, love's response to pain. Compassion, I suspect it is something we are all going to be called to exercise quite a bit in the coming months. The coronavirus is spreading throughout humanity. It is here in the United States, it has reached Houston, and our religious tradition calls us to be compassionate as we collectively respond to the viral outbreak. This compassion should take several forms. We should demand that our public officials allocate adequate resources and take swift, appropriate action to slow the spread of the coronavirus. We should demand that they cite scientific facts rather than their own emotional appeals when they speak about it in public. And we should not stigmatize particular groups of people, people of Asian descent, for instance, because we irrationally blame them for the virus. The virus has the potential to impact everyone, and people of all ages and ethnicities have the potential to be infected by it. And we should each do our part to limit the rate at which the virus propagates. Washing your hands frequently with hot water and ample soap, humming happy birthday twice through, not shaking hands. I've been encouraging people to bump forearms instead. Covering your cough with a Kleenex and then throwing the Kleenex away. These are actually compassionate acts in this difficult time. They are extensions of sympathy into action. So is staying home if you feel sick. We offer paid sick leave to our employees here at First Church. And if your workplace doesn't, and if you're sick and worried about missing a paycheck, contact me or Reverend Scott, and we will see how we can help you out. Clean surfaces like doorknobs and that people touch frequently, and hardest of all, avoid touching your face. These might all seem banal, but they are actually compassionate acts. They are ways that we put concerns for others and for ourselves into action. If the viral outbreak reaches epidemic proportions, here in Houston, the staff and I are prepared to continue to offer Sunday services and pastoral counseling online as part of our compassionate efforts to help the community weather the viral storm. Compassion. Now, looking around the sanctuary, I'm sure you have noticed that it looks a little bit different this morning. We have close to 60 photographs on our walls here and in the fireside room because of my belief that art can stir sympathy, empathy, and ultimately compassion within us. This year, our congregation is part of Photo Fest. Photo Fest is the longest running biennial of photography and lens-based art in the United States. It's also one of the largest art festivals in the world. It has an audience of around 275,000 people. We're serving as a participating space. That means that we're one of about 80 venues throughout the city who have chosen to be part of Photo Fest and exhibit art during the festival. Some of the other venues include the Museum of Fine Arts Houston, the Menil Collection, the Moody Center for Arts at Rice University, the Houston Museum of African American Culture, and the Houston Center for Photography. So we're in pretty good company. Photo Fest opened yesterday. That is why I should note that we are focusing on today and not women's history. We will be observing women's history throughout the month by drawing our readings exclusively from women, and with the exception of today, when Zofia invited us to support the International Convocation of Unitarian Universalist Women, we'll be supporting Planned Parenthood through our shared offering. And at the end of the month, I'll be offering the sermon I should have offered today, drawing from feminist and womanist theology that normally is given at the Sunday nearest the March 8th. Now, our exhibition is called Now is the Time, Leonard Fried's Photographs of South Africa's 1994 Election. My father, Dr. Howard Bawson, and I curated it together, and I'm pleased that my dad is with us this morning. And I would like to thank him and my mom, Kathy, for their tireless efforts to make the exhibit happen. And it's important also to thank First Church's fine staff, Alex, Alma, Gustavo, John, and Scott, all put in and continue to put in an extraordinary amount of work for Now is the Time. Tawana, our wonderful business administrator, deserves special mention because on top of everything else she does, she's served as project manager. We've also had help from the staff at the libraries of Michigan State University, CrateWorks Fine Arts Services, and Artist Framing Resources. We owe Bill Harrison a special thanks. Bill printed the images and then did a rush job to print a second set of images after UPS somehow lost the first one. And we owe Justin Grimswald from CrateWorks particular gratitude. Justin was here until 11:30 p.m. on Wednesday night with my father and I hanging the show. Turns out it's not so easy to mount art to brick walls. And none of this, of course, would be possible without our funders, Michigan State University, Thorpe Butler and Rita Saylors, and Lindley Doran and Charles Holman. And the exhibition showing would not be possible without all the assistance of our volunteer docents. Advertisement, of course, there is still space to be a volunteer docent if you'd like to help out in that way. Before we move on to the rest of the sermon, I want to tell you about how the show came about. A key part of the Photo Fest is the portfolio review process, and this is where artists and curators, editors and gallery owners, publishers and other industry professionals meet with photographers to look at the artist's work. Now, my father is a professor of photography and visual communication and has been a reviewer of Photo Fest for close to 20 years. So it turned out that when they found out I was moving to Houston, they told him that they'd been wanting to use our space as an exhibit for many years. And so my dad put me in touch with Stephen Evans, the executive director, to find a curator. Now this was back in June of last year, and I spent about 5 months working with that curator. And then in late November, I got a call from the curator. They'd not been able to raise the roughly $50,000 they needed for the exhibit that they were planning, and so they were backing out. And I asked Stephen what to do, and he told me that it was too late to pair us with another curator, so he said, why don't you ask your dad for some help? We would really like First Church to be part of Photo Fest. I can give you a week to figure things out. Now, a week is not a lot of time to plan an exhibit, but I called my dad, and well, here we are. And I'm excited that we can be a venue for Now is the Time. Leonard Fried, whose work we are featuring, was a major American photographer. He was a member of Magnum Photos, the world's premier photography collective. And for more than 50 years, he traveled the world documenting major events. He used his art to stir sympathy and compassion, and during the 1950s and 1960s, break the, quote, almost complete isolation between the races. His work is in collections like the Metropolitan Museum of Art in New York and the J. Paul Getty Museum in Los Angeles. Fried is best known for his photographs of the civil rights movement, particularly the set of images that were included in his 1968 book, Black and White America. It is a beautiful book. It documents African-American life in the last days of Jim Crow, and it documents African-American life in right after the end of legal segregation. There are a lot of powerful photographs in that book. One of the most affecting is a line of 8 or 9 African-Americans waiting to vote in a federal election for the first time in Washington, D.C. They're in one of those utilitarian spaces that often serve as polling places. I imagine it's a school gym or cafeteria, or maybe a church basement. They're all ages. There's a tall, distinguished gentleman wearing a tweed coat and well-pressed slacks and perfectly shined shoes. There's a young woman with a long coat and knee-high skirt with a large purse under her right arm. In her right hand, she is grasping a white slip of paper, presumably documenting that she's eligible to vote. Everyone in the photograph looks like they've been waiting for a long time, which, of course, they have. They've been waiting for however long they've been waiting in that line, and then they've been waiting for however long they've been alive. For this is the first time that any of them have voted in a national election. And so it doesn't matter that the man who is probably over 80 and that the woman is most likely under 30. They've both been waiting for precisely the same amount of time, their whole lives. And they look tired, because I bet the line is a long one. And they looked determined, because winning the right to vote was not easy. Viewed from the vantage of Houston, Texas in 2020, the photograph is actually quite disturbing. It could have been taken on Tuesday. It could have been taken in the 4th Ward or here in the 3rd Ward. It could have been taken in almost any community of color in Texas in the year 2020. Because since 2012, the state's Republican leadership has worked to close 750 polling places throughout this state. And the vast majority of those polling places that have been closed in communities of color. Now, on Tuesday, I voted in a polling place near Montrose in River Oaks. There were about half a dozen polling places for me to choose from within easy reach of my apartment. I live in an affluent and predominantly white area. And I went to the polling place. I waited for 15 minutes. Now, I have a friend who lives over in the 4th Ward, and she told me she waited over a half hour and a half to vote. And then, of course, there were some people who waited to vote at Texas Southern University, which I should remind you is a historically black university, for as many as 6 hours. Compassion is not just having sympathy for those people who have had to wait hours and hours to vote. It's putting that sympathy into action and organizing to demand that people have easy access to voting. Compassion. You can find images of people waiting to vote almost anywhere online. And these days, we're inundated by visual images almost all the time. They can overwhelm us. How many of you have a smartphone? And how many of you use Instagram, Facebook, or Twitter? Now, I have all of those things on my phone. They have this common feature called endless scroll. Endless scroll is that thing that repopulates your phone with images as you move your finger down the screen. No matter how many friends you have on Facebook or followers you have on Twitter, the social media companies constantly refresh your account so that you never run out of images. Endless scroll is just that, a string that seemingly goes on forever, that you can never reach the end of, that is always presenting you with new content, new images, new videos, new sources of stimulation. Endless scroll can be entrancing. I do not know about you, but I sometimes have the experience of scrolling from image to image on an Instagram without even knowing what I'm doing. Sometimes I look up and realize that 15 minutes have passed. It would be difficult for me to tell you what I saw or engaged with during that time. It all went by in a sort of catatonic blur. The social media accounts I follow come from all over the world. I follow news sources like the New York Times, the Guardian, the Houston Chronicle, and La Jornada, a very fine daily out of Mexico City. I follow a painter from Japan and anarchist labor union organizers from Spain, political organizers from northern Syria, photographers from the Czech Republic, historians, philosophers, theologians, religious leaders from, well, really almost anywhere. And then there are my actual friends, who in our highly connected global world live on every continent except for Antarctica. One of the wonderful things about social media is that it actually can link people throughout the world together. I have, through my smartphone or computer, access to the words, sounds, images, and ideas from people who live in bustling cities and remote villages. If I want to, I can actually communicate directly with them and find out something more about their human experience, and I can share some of mine with them. And maybe our digital interaction opens us up to being compassionate towards each other and helping us to recognize that truth about human experience, lifted up in the seventh principle of our Unitarian Universalist Association. We are all connected, all part of the great web of being, all members of the great family of all souls. Whatever happens to you happens in some major or minor way to me as well. One of the terrible things about social media is that it can make people numb to what is going on throughout the world. And again, I've had this experience myself. I look at my phone and there's an image of someone dying under Assad's brutal regime in Syria. I look at my phone and there's an image of people suffering from the coronavirus, first in China, then in Italy, and now, well, here in the United States. I look at my phone and there's an image of a young African-American man who's been killed by the police. I look at my phone and there's images of immigration and customs enforcement officers placing children in cages. There are images of there's a lot of awful images out there. Images that provide a testament of just how terrible we human beings are to each other. And you know what? I usually think to myself, I cannot deal with this right now. And so I scroll past the world's horrors and look at pictures of a friend's dog's birthday party, a friend drinking beer at a very cute graffiti-covered bar in New York, a nice-looking dancing competition, a couple's anniversary, one partner dressed in a striking red dress, the other in a tuxedo, a delicious meal of fresh market vegetables, and of course, cats. Like a lot of the world, I like images of cats. Cats running, sleeping, or playing with some kind of improbable object. Cats are cute, cats are goofy, cats bring a smile to my face. And cats, like so many of these other images, help me to forget the brutal things we do to each other. Do you ever have the same experience, where you look at the difficult news of the world and think to yourself, I just can't? A bit more than a decade ago, when she was trying to grapple with the constant barrage of images of the Bush regime's torture policy that were then appearing in the New York Times and in other places in the then dominant print media, the philosopher Susan Sontag observed, an ample reserve of stoicism is needed to get through the great newspaper of record each morning, given the likelihood of seeing photographs that could make you cry. I suspect that the constant barrage of graphic images induces what's called compassion fatigue in a lot of us. Compassion fatigue is the anger, dissociation, and anxiety, sometimes even nightmares, that we experience from feeling powerless to change the world's ills. It comes from what Sontag called that quintessential modern experience of being a spectator of calamities taking place in another place. Endless Scroll offers us the opportunity to spectate endless and exhausting calamities. It can dilute the power of the image to open us up to compassion. And that's one reason why I think exhibits like Now is the Time and social documentary photography remain important even when we are surrounded by images at all time. The framed image mounted on the wall offers us the chance to stop and to consider the human experience or the natural world in a moment of time. Now, of course, all photographs are curated representations of reality. There's always something outside of the frame. The image is always partial and seen through the lens of the photographer. The photographer's aesthetics and ethics, their choice of what to represent and how to represent it, is always shaping what we see. When a photographer produced an image, they indicated that this transitory moment of time, this flitting bit of consciousness and experience and matter, was worth preserving. Fried's work in Now is the Time preserves impressions of a historic shift, the end of apartheid in South Africa. He traveled there for 3 weeks to document the country's first multiracial election. As a white Jewish man from the United States, a white Jewish man who knew about the Holocaust and Jim Crow and the struggle for civil rights, he created his curated representation of the election that brought Nelson Mandela and the African National Congress to power. His images are not the images that would have been made by someone from a different social location. They're not the images made by a black South African who participated in the struggle to end apartheid. And they're not the images of someone who had suffered the social stigma of Jim Crow. Nonetheless, they are designed to open their viewers to the fullness of the human experience, to remind us that there is joy and friendship and wonder, even in the most desolate of places. That human society can shift, that apartheid ended. The title of the exhibit comes from one of the African National Congress's slogans during the 1994 election, "Now is the time." The slogan is evocative of Fried's photograph of the people waiting in line to vote. Now is the time to change. It has finally come. After all these years of suffering and struggling and waiting, now is the time. It has arrived. Now is the time to be compassionate towards each other and act together. Now is the time. If you want to learn more about the exhibit, I invite you to come to my father's lecture on March 15th at 7 p.m. I'll also be offering a gallery tour at least once between now and the end of April. And I hope that you'll take time after the service or during the exhibit's hours to study the photographs. There are a few that we've placed behind a curtain because they're not appropriate for Sunday mornings. But all of them, I hope, will offer you the opportunity to interrupt the endless scroll of visual imagery and look carefully at a transitory moment of time, constructed representation that will do a little to help you with whatever compassion fatigue you might be experiencing. As you do, I invite you to remember words from Nikki Giovanni that we heard earlier in the service. We must believe in each other's dreams, I'm told, and I dream of me accepting you and you accepting yourself. Such words remind us of the possibility of compassion. And as you view Fried's images, I invite you to consider these words by Nelson Mandela, words that he offered in his inaugural address as president of South Africa. We know it well that none of us acting alone can achieve success. We must therefore act together as a united people, for national reconciliation, for nation building, for the birth of a new world. Let there be justice for all. Let there be peace for all. Let there be work, bread, and salt for all. Let each know that for everybody, the mind, the body, and the soul have been freed to fulfill themselves. We would do well to hear Mandela's words. They challenge us to be compassionate, to take our sympathy and empathy for others, sympathy and empathy that are rooted in our shared human experience, and transform that sympathy and empathy into the action of compassion. We would also do well to pause and look and see if we can be stirred to compassion by the rich visual imagery on display throughout the city of Houston during Photo Fest. Our faith calls us to be compassionate, and the art which surrounds us during these festival months has the possibility of inspiring us greater depths of compassion, to transform our sympathy and empathy into action. We are one human family, one world community, whether we like it or not. If we are to survive and thrive, we must be compassionate towards each other. Let us remember that, and in doing so, let us recognize that now is the time to act, to work together for voting rights, to do what we can to combat the coronavirus, no shaking hands after the service, to seek justice, and to build the beloved community. Now is the time. That it might be so, I invite the congregation to say Amen.